Hi, I'm Bill Ritchie. Isn't this exciting? I'm building four presses at a time. One for Phil, one for Jennifer, one for Roger, and one for Richard. Number 63, 64, 65, 66. And when I get them done, I'll be able to test the presses to make sure they work. You know, I can't tell you how much fun this is, putting together these mini Halfwood presses. All the little spacers and the little certain size screws that I have here, and all these parts. And all the time I'm working, I think how much fun it would be to be sharing this with other people, teaching other people how to make mini Halfwood press bases and assembling the presses. I wonder if people would like to come and learn how to make mini Halfwood presses and then go home back to where they live and maybe open a shop like mine and make mini Halfwood presses according to my design. So I'm thinking about the kind of a training program or a school or apprenticeship, licensing, franchise, I don't know what. Because making presses is just like making guitars or violins or special one-of-a-kind instruments to sell to other people. It's intensive work, it's hard in a lot of ways, but mostly it's pleasurable. It's a very pleasurable work. Let me know what you think. I'm Bill Ritchie. I was working on this cross piece for a galleon, and my shoulder was hurting, and I thought, I can't go on doing this, making these Halfwood presses. I'm getting to be too old. My joints can't take it anymore. I just can't keep on doing it. And I realized that someone younger than me, someone like Mike, for example, is 40 years old and could use the work. He could be polishing these. And I thought, yeah, but I only have four of these presses to make, and wouldn't take him but a few hours to polish all these pieces. But then again, what if he had to polish about 20 or even 50 of them? And I began to realize that I've been measuring the making of the mini Halfwood presses and the galleons and all the others by my standards, how much I can do in one day. An old man with growing pains and so forth, and that's what's stopping me from realizing my dream, which is to make hundreds or thousands of Halfwood presses. I can't do it by myself. Even with Mike's help, I couldn't do it. But I'm always thinking in terms of making one or two presses and how painful that is. So that's the governor on this business, so-called business. That's the governor. That's what's stopping this business from going full speed. Me. Brass plates. I associate brass plates with quality. Like you go into an art museum and there'll be masterpieces and there'll be a brass plate showing who the artist was who made that masterpiece. I'm making these brass plates for my Halfwood presses. Now I'm thinking as I do this, I can only do this for another 6 months, and then what? Maybe I'll spend the next 6 months making brass plates for my own artworks, my own masterpieces in my art gallery. And somebody said, that my Halfwood Presses are artworks. That surprised me at first, but one person said, they make me happy, therefore it's art. Hi, I'm Bill Ritchie. You know, lately I've been thinking about selling the business of Halfwood Press, but I've decided a better idea is to share it with everybody all over the world. I've had interest from everybody all over the world. So what I'm proposing that we do together as a global community is create that printer's chest I described, except have it equipped with the products and ideas from all of the people who have already bought many Halfwood Presses, Galleons, and Mariners. This is my proposal. Some people are already in business making supplies and equipment for printmaking. For example, we have a man on the east coast of the United States designing a new brayer. Out here in Seattle, we have a man who, while he doesn't own a press yet, is working on a better kind of a mezzotint tool, combination of a roulette and mezzotint. This printer's chest should have everything in it you need to be a printmaker or a printmaking student. You would have the press, of course, the mini Halfwood, mass-produced, more or less, and everything you need to learn and practice printmaking. All four processes, the intaglio, the relief, the stencil, and the planographic. That's my goal as a teacher, that's my dream. And I think as a world community, a global community, we could pull this off and we could share in the profits if there are any, or at least get our money back, get some of the time or value back that we put into this world community project. I call it Printmaking World, as you know, and I'm inviting you to submit your ideas. Send me your ideas. Tell me what you think of my idea of building a printer's chest put together from all over the United States or all over the world for printmakers and wannabe printmakers and teachers worldwide. I'm Bill Ritchie. Send me an email, ritchie@printmakingworld.com. Hi, I'm Bill Ritchie, and I welcome you to my Halfwood Press workshop in Seattle, where every year the apprentice users making mini Halfwood Presses send their entries for the annual certification program. We have here some of the entries that arrived recently. I'll go over a couple of them and point out some of the facts. I should mention too that I am the sole judge of the quality of workmanship and craft and art that goes into the making of the mini Halfwood Presses. The winners and those who are approved will go on to open their own pressmaking workshops, selling and distributing their Halfwood Presses as they have learned from me. Again, this is to assure the quality of mini Halfwood Presses forever, starting with the annual certification procedures. I'll start with one press that was submitted by a craftsman, an artisan in Arizona. And she chose to use one of Arizona's native woods for her entry. She's made it almost entirely from mesquite, and I must say it's a very good job. I will be examining this press in great detail. Here's another entry. This one, I have to comment, was sent incomplete. Apparently there was some problem with getting materials to finish the bed, but otherwise it's a complete press, and at a glance it looks like it's very well done. This one comes from Oregon. I have to smile because the entry from Florida came in pieces. Apparently another problem with getting enough materials and supplies to complete her press. Well, that's all I wanted to show you for now. I have about 14 presses to study, and I will be giving certification awards to probably about a fourth, perhaps a third of those entries. That's the way it's starting out. Now, I'm Bill Ritchie. Thanks for watching. Goodbye. Man, look at it snowing in there. It doesn't snow like this very often in Seattle, but when it does and when I'm in my shop and I'm working on a press, I'm really grateful. And to think about all the other people that are scattered around the United States who could be in their cozy little workshops, their Halfwood Press workshops, working on mini presses and galleons and mariners. I only have 300 square feet here. How many other people out there, maybe my age in their 60s, or maybe someone starting out in their 30s, or someone just out of a job, but have the skills of an artist, a craftsman, a designer to make these Halfwood presses? And I could help them do that. I think about that on days like this. If you read my story, the Halfwood Press, the story, you may remember that I calculated there's a market out there for presses like this, about 400,000 people. I was talking to a friend recently. He's a almost retired business executive, and he's in business. And when I told him there's a market for 400,000, he said, "Oh well, you know, that's wishful thinking." He said, "You're going to have to come up with justification for the number like that, 400,000 people." And after about 5 minutes, he was looking at one of my mini Halfwood presses, and he said, "You know, I'm going to buy one of these." And he's not even an artist. He's a retiring businessman. He buys my art. He bought several works of my art. And he looks at my mini Halfwood press and he said, "That's a work of art. And I'm going to buy one of those." You see the humor in that, don't you? Someone once asked me where I got the idea for the Halfwood Press Network. It goes back a long way, but right now I'm working on a piece of side piece for a mini Halfwood for a woman named Sandra. And sometimes when I'm working on pieces like this and thinking about the people that I'm making presses for, I get these ideas, and that's how the Halfwood Press Network came into being. Sandra happens to have a degree from the Cordage College of Art here in Seattle, renowned college, and she's in her maybe late 20s, and she's interested not only in a press for intaglio printmaking, but she's also interested in vitriography, something they don't teach at Cornish. And so the Halfwood Press Network would work for her because it's also an incubator for new startups, little one-person or, you know, a few people in cooperative studios, incubators, they call them in the business world. And I could propose to her that she prepare a teaching package for vitriography, something she wants to learn. Someone once said the best way to learn something is to teach it. So by producing a kit or lessons on how to do vitriography on a mini Halfwood press, Sandra could perhaps carve out a nice little niche for herself. And that's just one of the reasons that I wanted to start the Halfwood Press Network in the first place, a kind of combination of cooperative studio and an incubator for people interested in printmaking. Now back to work. Now I was thinking today about the notion of an old saying that I used to have of, "Now is the time for all good men to come to the aid of their country or their party." And I was thinking, now is the time for all printmakers to come to the aid of their art medium. Because until the Halfwood Press came along with its lightweight and its small footprint and lower consumption of materials and supplies and etc., all we had were big presses that few people could afford. And when you think of all the people who studied printmaking in school or took workshops and so forth but can't continue it, and how the population who can go to school and use those big presses anyway is probably declining. We might be talking about the end of the art medium called printmaking that we, those of us who love the hands-on process, have learned to love. So I would call printmakers to become pressmakers, using my idea of the Halfwood Press Network, where you have many small workshops, garage independent workshops, making many Halfwood presses under my help, my license or whatever, as a cooperative perhaps to sort of save printmaking from obscurity. That's what I was thinking. Hi, here I am again working on my greatest invention of my lifetime. It's a printmaker's chest. Has everything in it you need to do printmaking, to learn printmaking or to teach printmaking. And this is the chest. It's actually not finished. And the idea is that everything, including the press, is inside the box. It goes actually like this. But it doesn't drop in the box. From the top, it actually comes in from the side, fits in there like that. And what I was working on kind of reminded me of the building model ships. That's something that fascinated me ever since I was a little boy, because right in here are two tiny little gaps, and I have to cut a tiny little piece of wood about in here and put it in those gaps, and that's what reminded me of the miniature aspects of making model ships. Model ships actually have a relationship to this because the printer's chest is based on the navigator's chest, which is part of a story that I wrote myself about a mystery ship that left Europe in the 1750s and sunk near here, near Seattle, in off an island that I call Two Dog Island, which is actually Gwen's own. Long story. Anyway, it's a long story, an interesting story, and I'm writing a screenplay, and I'm writing a game, and my goal is to be a teacher, an interesting teacher of printmaking, and this is part of it. When I go out and cut wood, when I cut on my saws, and I cut into a piece of wood, the wood talks to me. And I'll tell you a story. When I was a student at Central Washington University in Ellensburg, I would go out on the countryside on my bicycle and draw. One day I was drawing a tree, and I had this strangest feeling that the tree was talking to me. And I went home. I was very much changed by that experience. Later, I went to graduate school at San Jose University, and we were required to have a thesis, a master's degree thesis, and I chose trees as my thesis, and I had various names for it, but it had to do with the tree as a symbol of life, and it was from that experience in Ellensburg. Now that's 40, almost 50 years ago. And today as I was cutting wood, that feeling came back again. The wood I'm cutting is dead wood. But it's almost like saying that if you're cutting down trees and killing the trees, you have to somehow pay back. You have to give back. You can't give back the life to that tree you're cutting, but you might listen to it. And again, it's almost as if the wood is talking to me. I know it sounds funny, but I get these messages. It's sort of like if you make something beautiful out of this wood, Bill Ritchie, it will be a kind of repayment. If you make something beautiful out of this wood, Bill Ritchie, and other people can make something beautiful using this half-wood press, it will be a kind of repayment. And I reflected on this as I was cutting on my table saw today, and I decided to make this confession videotape, that in a way it's true. And when I look back, and when I needed ideas, when I was a graduate student, needing an idea for a master's thesis, the tree would promise me that if I would evangelize, might be the right word, about trees, that in return I would get ideas and inspiration, even from the dead wood of a printer's chest or a wood block I carve. Well, that's what came back to me. I read a book recently by Jane McCormick. Anyway, she wrote a book called Reality is Broken, and in that book she quotes a lot of scientific evidence that shows that flow, or the state of flow, state of happiness and involvement, and the feeling that you're using all of your resources, is great for your mental health. I like to think of it as a cure for depression. We knew that, my co-worker Carl Chu and I knew that years ago, when we worked on a game called Art Student, and another game we worked on, our subtitle was The Cure for Depression. And what I'm doing now is inventing a printer's chest, a printmaker chest, and I just figured out, I just invented how to support certain shelves and how to use strips of copper partly for their decorative appearance and so forth. What a sense of flow that does give me. I've got to tell you, that's the way it is. Why don't you join me? Why don't you communicate with me? And together we'll take this even further into the realm of video games, which is what Jane I can't think of her name, is writing about. Her book, Reality is Broken, talks about reality being too easy, too predictable, too manageable, whereas games, whether they be computer games or board games or any kind of game activity, is taxing and really draws on your resources. And that's what I feel when I'm making printmaker chests and mini half-wood presses and dealing with all the little setbacks and necessities for inventing, working with the materials and so forth. You could join me. We could do it in a virtual world, or we could do it in reality. Come to Seattle. Come and try it out. Let's have a workshop. Hi, I'm Bill Ritchie, and I'm actually playing a game right now. This is a printmaker's chest, and the game I'm playing requires that I level up. If you're familiar with computer games, you know that leveling up means working from lower levels to higher levels of achievement. You do this because of your assets, your resources, your skills, and so forth. So I'm a skilled player of this game. I call it various names. One I like the most is called Emeralda, Games for the Gifts of Life. To level up in Emeralda, you have to have resources like an electric screwdriver, $20 at Home Depot. You have to have skills in woodworking. You also have to do multitasking. While I'm working on this printmaker chest, I'm also etching a plate over there in that tray underneath that other etching press that I'm making. I make etching presses, I make printmaker chests, I make prints, I etch plates for testing the presses. There's a kind of a recursive action going on in this game. It's an exciting game for me, and I worked for 40 or 50 years to get to this point of playing Emeralda. And the interesting thing too is that I, like you, win gold in the virtual games like Worlds of Warcraft or
different games you know. I actually win gold too, although it comes in the form of checks and PayPal online orders and so forth for those etching presses and printmaker chests that I make, and once in a while for a print. I think maybe this is really what I want to do, is work on chests for the mini half-wood press. Because, well, look at this. This printmaker chest has almost everything you need in it to be a printmaker. It has the mini half-wood press. It has the boxes for storing your things, more spaces for storing, everything you need. In fact, you could have the galvanic etching system that allows you to make prints with electricity instead of the ferric chloride. More of a green process. In this space here, I could have a DVD player with the lessons and a book. I think that's what I'd rather like to do. This is slow and meditative work, working on the parts of a mini half-wood press. Actually, this is a galleon press. It's slow and meditative. And what I meditate on is the person who gets this press. And she wrote to me an email and she said, "I'm so excited about my press." So I think about her. And I think about when she gets this press and she sees the details that I put into it. But it goes beyond that. I'm meditating on the fact that she'll get the press one day. She'll make prints with the press, and I can think about that. But in this day and age, what we're talking about is a kind of interactive game over time and space. We could use the internet. She could tell me when she's made a press, a print. Maybe she'll tell me when she made a press. The point is, if we create an online game for printmaking, it would begin with the press making and the meditation that goes on in the making of the press. It would continue then on the web with some sort of short interactive messages or images that document or track the progress as we work toward some notion of our ideal world, what I call printmaking world. And that's the point. The meditative process of making the press, meditating on the person that's going to get the press, imagining what the person will do when he or she gets the press, and then finally, what comes of it all. If we communicate, what else are we thinking about? What are the bigger issues? Because we are part of a bigger thing. This is like the epic aspect of computer games today.